Welcome back. In this mini lesson, we will learn about the so-called stratified sampling technique, which is one of the general variance reduction methods. So, for the explanation of the stratified sampling technique, I'm going to assume the simplest possible formulation of the Monte Carlo simulation. So we formulated it in this way, where the output variable y, the output random variable y, is given by a numerical model that can be described by a function g that takes as the input a random variable x. So g is a function that transforms the input variable x into the output variable y. So because it is a function, we can draw it in the plot form like this. So the function may look, for instance, like this. So this is the gx function. Now when I draw the shape of the g function like this, it wasn't random. I had a reason for it. When we run the Monte Carlo simulation, we sample the x values from the probability density function fx, right? So we use this function to select values of the x random variable, right? So for instance, we select a value here. So that means that the simulation will give the output y value here. Next time we select the x random variable value, it may fall here. So then the value would coincide with the previous sample, but the next sample could fall here, for instance, and the y value would be smaller. Now when you look at the distribution of the output samples, the y samples, how does it look like? Well, it very much depends on the probability density function for the input random variable x, but let's just assume for a while that the probability density function for the input variable x is flat. So let's just say that it looks like this. So this is the probability density function for x. So it's a uniform distribution between the minimum and the maximum value, which can be, for instance, here. So when we are selecting the values for the input x random variable from the flat probability density function, most of the samples will actually go to this part where the g function is more or less flat. Yeah? So therefore the output will always fall in the same value. And a smaller part, like it looks like 30% of the samples, will fall into the location where the output random variable can vary between the minimum and the maximum value. So as you can see, most of the samples in our simulation will fall here, and a minority will fall into this location. So we could draw also probability density function for the output random variable that would look like this. So let's say that we have the maximum value, I will denote it by y max. So let's say that that is here. So at this value, there will be a peak, right? And all the smaller value will have a relatively small probability density function. So there will be a jump up at the maximum value. Now, during the simulation, most of the samples will fall here to the maximum value. But the maximum value is known pretty well, because the value of the output random variable doesn't change very much within this interval. It's around the same value from here till here. Yet, most of the samples that we generate will fall here. So we are like sampling the same value most of the time. Now, our aim is to calculate the mean value of all the samples. We want to estimate the expectation value of the output random variable. So we need to calculate the mean value of all the samples. Now, to calculate the mean value, or to estimate the expectation value of the output random variable, we need to have a very good description of this probability density function for the output random variable. We need to have very good information about what is the probability density function from the minimum to the maximum. But yet, most of the samples will fall here, where the value is known to pretty good precision, because it doesn't change very much. So it would make sense for us to devote more of the samples into this location, into this interval, where the output random variable does change a lot, right? From its minimum value to the maximum. If we just sample randomly the input random variable from the minimum to the maximum, most of the samples will fall in this area. That means they will produce only one value, or they will produce samples, the output variable samples, with very small variance around this value. Now, the idea of the stratified sampling method is to split the range of the input random variable X into several groups. They are called strata. So, for instance, we could have the first group X1 and the second group X2. And then we would have several stages in the simulation. In the first stage, we would calculate, or we would sample the X1 random variable at first, so all the samples would be generated within this interval only. And in the next part of the simulation, we would sample values only from the X2 variable, so only the values that would be falling into this range would be simulated. Then the method assumes that we are free to choose the number of samples that we generate within each group. So, for instance, in this arrangement that we have, it would be more reasonable to generate more samples in the first group, because the spread of the Y values of the output random variable is much bigger in the first group, while in the second group all the samples fall into the same value of the output random variable. So, you know, even if we sample the second group by only several samples, you will get very good estimation of the mean value of all the samples within the second group. So the idea is to separately estimate the mean value or the expectation value of the output random variable within each group, and at the end of the calculation these estimates can be combined. So the stratified sampling method tries to direct the samples into those locations where they can improve the precision of the final mean value the most. So this is the general idea of the method, and let's have a look at some details. The division of the range for the input random variable X can be done into many groups. So we have used two groups in our example, but it can be many groups. So let's just assume that we have L groups, and we can number these groups according to the group index. So XI denotes the ith group. Now, when we divide the input random variable into X group, then it also divides the output random variable Y into corresponding groups YI. So we can also number them according to the group indices. Now, to use the stratified sampling method well, we actually need to have some information about the system. So we need the information in order to design the division of the groups. So in our example, we had the system that had this numerical model given by the function gx. And we have this, we have designed two groups, x1 and x2 here. So I think it became clear from the example why did we decide to design the second group in this region. It was because the value for the output random variable was about the same throughout the region of the second group. So that means the variance of the output variable was very small in this group. The variance was small, it was always falling in the same value. And this is the general approach how the group should be designed. They should be designed in such a way that the variance of the output random variable within each group is minimized. So that is described by this point here. So in order to do this, we need to have some knowledge. Now, that is not surprising to us. We know already that all the general variance reduction techniques require knowledge about the problem if you want to use them for reduction of the variance. Now, when you look at the region of the first group, there is not really much what we can do. We could possibly split the first region into more groups, so then within each group the variance of the output random variable would be smaller, but there would be more groups for which we would have to estimate the expectation value of the output random variable within each group. So we wouldn't really gain anything out of this. So we can keep this region as one group only. Now, the input random variable X is described by its probability density function fx. Now, this function is known, otherwise we couldn't sample the values to the input random variable if we didn't know it. So we know this function precisely, and therefore we can actually calculate exactly the probability that a sample falls into a specific group. So we denote this probability by omega. So omega 1 denotes the probability that the random variable X is sampled into the first group. Now let me bring back the example that I used before, where the system was described by the function that had this shape. So this is our input variable x, the output variable y, and we had the group x1 and x2. Now the omega probability depends on the probability density function, which is not described here, but we can just assume that it's flat, as we have assumed before. So if it is flat, so it looks like this, then the omega would be, in this case, something about 0.3. So omega 1 would be 0.3, so omega 2 would be 0.7. However, if the probability density function for the input variable x look differently, right, for instance like this, then the omega 1 would be bigger than 0.3. Now it's probably obvious to you that the same omegas apply also to the division of the output random variable y, because each sample that falls into the first group will also generate the output random variable in the first group as well, right? Every sample of the input random variable x that falls into the second group will generate the output random variable within the second group as well. So the omegas, they can be applied also to the division of the output random variable y. So the idea of the stratified sampling technique is to evaluate the expectation value of the output random variable within each group. So we have L values of these expectation values of the output variable y within each group. So if we know all the expectation value of the output random variable within each group, then we can derive the final expectation value over all the groups. However, we have to weight the expectation values according to the omegas. Fortunately, we know the omegas exactly. So we know the omegas, but we do not know the expectation value exactly. So we need to estimate them by the mean values. So the idea is to generate samples within each group, estimate the expectation value by the mean values, and combine all the mean values within the different groups and weight them according to the omegas. So the weighting by the omegas is necessary in order to reflect correctly the distribution of the input random variable samples. It is possible to show that the variance of the final mean value of the result of the output random variable y is given by this equation. Notice the summation over L groups, and within each of these terms that is the variance of the output random variable in the ith group divided by the number of samples that we generated within that group. Now this is interesting because we have not decided on the number of these samples. We have so far suggested the general idea that when there is a group in which the variance of the output random variable is small, then we could possibly use smaller number of the samples, but we didn't specify exactly how to do this yet. So let's have a look now at the optimal distribution of the samples into different groups. It's possible to prove that the greatest reduction of the variance can be obtained by the so-called Neyman allocation, which is given by this equation. So Ni gives the number of samples within the ith group. N is the total number of the samples. So that is the number that you may decide before the simulation, for instance. Then omega I that we know, that is the probability that the sample falls into the ith group. So this number we can calculate before the simulation as well. And then we have the standard deviation of the output random variable y within the ith group. So this we don't know before the simulation starts, and that's a problem. So I will talk about this a little bit later. Let's complete the description of the formula here. This term in the denominator is only needed in order to make sure that when you sum up the number of samples over all the groups, you will get the total number of the samples that you wanted to generate. So this is just kind of normalization. Now let's come back to the problem of the unknown standard deviation of the output random variable within each group. A common way to solve this problem is to divide the whole simulation into several stages. In the first stage, you can assign the same number of samples into every group. Based on the outcomes, you can estimate the standard deviation of the output random variable within each group. So based on this estimate, you can use the Neyman allocation to decide the number of the samples within each group for the second stage. And within the second stage, you can improve on the estimates of the standard deviation of the output random variable within each group. So then you can improve the division, and you can run over several stages. There is a risk that if you do not sample sufficient number of values and in the first stage, then the estimates for the standard deviation of the output random variable may contain very large errors, and you may decide incorrectly the division of the samples for the second stage. So to avoid this problem, you have to make sure that you have sufficiently good statistics for the first stage of the simulation, so that the estimates of the standard deviations here would be accurate enough in order to make the Neyman allocation correctly. That is all for now. Have a nice day.